My name is John Ross with the Art of Retouching Studio, and inside of this video, I'm going to be talking about how I use smart objects inside of every one of my retouched images. It doesn't matter if it's a portrait or a composite, smart objects are definitely the way you should be retouching your images. When it comes to portraits, I see many, many students of mine submitting images to me that simply use pixel-based information. And when I ask them to go back and make a change, they need to build on top of the existing layers. And in many times, they'll even collapse layers to put more layers on top of it. And ultimately, that's just not the most effective way to work. So let me show you a couple different ways that I use smart objects within my basic portrait workflow. And now the first place that Photoshop's going to open it up isn't actually in Photoshop. It's going to be opened up inside of Camera Raw, otherwise referred to as ACR, Adobe Camera Raw. And inside of Camera Raw, you're allowed to make some basic tonal corrections as well as color changes. Now, Camera Raw is extremely powerful software, and if you don't know how to use it, you really should learn. But for the case of this video, I'm just going to jump right in and make some basic changes right here within this base tool palette. So it's a very simple, basic place to start. This works for me. Now, normally what you can do is click this Open Image button. And what's going to happen is it's going to open it up inside of Photoshop as a single layer. Right now we're inside of Adobe Photoshop as a simple flattened background layer made of pixels. If I wanted to go back to the Camera Raw file in order to adjust the exposure or color or something like that, I can't actually do it. Because we've come into Photoshop, all we can do is start adding adjustment layers. However, there's a much better way to work. I'm going to close this file and say no, and instead I'm going to drag and drop that same image back into Photoshop. Once again, it's going to open up as Camera Raw. Instead of clicking Open Image, I'm going to hold down the Shift key. That's going to change it to Open Object. You see that? This is Open Image. Shift key is Open Object. So now in this case, it will no longer be a flattened background layer, but instead, it's going to open it up as a smart object. Now there's two different ways to know that this is a smart object. One of which is, you can see that it didn't bring it in as a background layer. Rather, it brought it in as the name of the original file. Additionally, you can see this funny little icon down here, and that symbolizes that it's a smart object. So now, if I want to make a tonal or color change, all I need to do is double-click on the thumbnail itself, and then we get brought right back into Adobe Camera Raw, where I can go and make further changes to this image. So I'll just make this really, really bright, go OK. It'll think about it for a moment. When it finishes, we'll see the change done to the layer within Adobe Photoshop. And as you can see, the change I made in the smart object gets forwarded into Photoshop, and now we can continue to work. And if we don't like that change, we can simply go Edit, Undo, and then we're back to where we were. A smart object is really nothing more than a container. Simply, we have a file, which is the raw information, inside of this layer right here. So if and when we want to access this information again, all we need to do is double click on it and we go right back into where the file was saved within the smart object. So now inside of a traditional workflow, what you would need to do is make a duplicate copy of the layer so that you have one as the original and then the other one is going to be the filter that you use, and then you would run the filter on the secondary layer. However, you don't actually have to do that when you work with a smart object. Rather, we can work right on the smart object and it's going to retain all of the filter settings so that we can once again access them later. Simply as an example, I'm going to go filter, noise, add noise. Not that I expect you to do this, but if I take this noise amount and I crank it all the way up and we can see that the change happened to the image, I click OK. Now you can see that we have a smart filter and attached to that is add noise. And if I zoom in on this image here, you can see that there's a whole lot of noise. And let's say, wow, we didn't mean to do that. All we need to do is double click on the add noise again, and it's going to once again open up that same filter with the same settings. So now we can change it to something completely different. We can drop the amount down and then go OK. Now notice that it actually retained that information once again. We have our add noise. When I double click on it, we have the exact same settings that we did before. I can drop it down again, and basically I can fine tune this until I'm absolutely happy with it. And I can add as many smart filters as I want to the image. So in this case, let me show you if I add noise and bring this back up to a relatively high value, and I'll go okay. So right now we have a noise value of 15. Simply as an example, if I go filter, sharpen, unsharp mask, and I also give this a fairly high value, just so that we can clearly see the change, and go okay. Here you can now see that it's sharpened the noise. See, if I undo, this is just the noise, and now we have the sharpening of the noise. The way that Photoshop actually looks at this is we have our base layer, then we have add noise, then we have the sharpening. So basically, it's sharpening the noise. But what if we realize we should have done it in the other order? We want to sharpen the image, then add the noise. Well, that's no more complicated than rearranging the layer structure. Click on the unsharp mask, drag it below the add noise, and let go. Then it's going to reorder the file, and now instead of sharpening the noise, it sharpens the image, then the noise. By simply changing the order of the smart filters, like anything else in Photoshop, layer order matters. Now, once again, if I told you to go back to the raw file and make a color change, if you were working with this with multiple copies, you couldn't do that. In this case, if I double click on the thumbnail, I go right back into Camera Raw. I can take this saturation, boost it all the way up, go OK, and then it's going to fix the saturation, then it's going to sharpen, then it's going to add noise. And all of this has happened from the same base layer with different filters attached to it. And if you don't want to look at these extra filters, just click on this little arrow and it sucks them up. And then we can continue to build on top of this. Simply, a smart object is a container for other layers and other files. And as an offshoot of the smart object, you can place smart filters on top of it while it retains that information. Additionally, smart filters have a mask that you can attach to them. That's what this white thumbnail is right here. Just like layer masks, we can paint directly on this white layer and tell it where it should and should not apply that filter. So for example, if I zoom in on this image and I take my paintbrush and I paint with black right across the eyes, notice that I'm simply erasing the effects of unsharp mask and add noise with this mask right here. Just like layer masks, black conceals, white reveals. Now in this case, I've decided I don't even want these filters applied anymore. I want to go back to the base image. All I have to do is click on the smart filter or any of the subfilters and simply drag them into the trash and they go away and they are no longer applied. I'm sure by now you can see how incredibly powerful smart objects are, and this is just scratching the surface, and I'm not even doing anything incredibly complicated to the image at this point. Smart objects can even be used in high-end retouching. It works extremely well with high-pass sharpening and other variants just like it, as well as high-frequency and low-frequency separation. Due to the time constraints of this video, I can't go into excessive detail, but if you would like to learn how I turned this image into this final retouched image using smart objects and other photo retouching techniques like frequency separation, high pass, low pass, dodge and burn, as well as other beauty techniques, simply go to www.theartofretouching.com and there you can find a behind the scenes video of how I worked on this particular image, where I'll walk you through each of the many different steps that I went through in order to achieve this final image. So if you would like to learn more about me or the retouching that I do, as well as the many videos and tutorials that I have on basic through advanced retouching, as well as behind the scenes videos where my students have submitted images to me, where I critique them, evaluate them, and also retouch them myself, showing best practices and best techniques. So once again, my name is John Ross with the Art of Retouching Studio. If you would like to watch more videos like this one, please go to www.theartofretouching.com where you can find more tips and tricks to make you a better photo retoucher.